deal with those issues. So that carried on for quite a lot of years, lots of interventions put in place, lots of operations to deal with issues such as the vandalism, to make it increase reports and incidents as well. And that carried on. We've since had a reduction during those years in the police community support offices. Now there's only NADWIC on the bus network, and we've reduced the funding to British Transport Police as well. 2014, a new strategy was produced from some consultation with partners. We reviewed the travel safe board that oversees the strategic side of travel safe, and then we developed an action plan to focus delivery, which continued for 3 years, which brings us up to where we are today. So in 2017, we reviewed a new strategy, which I'll go into more detail in a minute. Before we go on to the new strategy, I thought it might be important just to outline some of the successes that the partnership has had to date. Really reiterate the full confidence that the field of personal safety is high and there's low level of incidents on the network. Research by Transport Focus shows that between 78-87% of people are satisfied with their feelings of safety and security on the bus and rail network, that's either travelling on the train or the bus or waiting for that bus or train. But I will say fear of crime is a barrier to people travelling, and in research by the Department of Transport quite a few dozen years says that fear of crime will reduce ridership on the network by 11.5%, so people won't travel because of their fear of that. Passengers also continue to emphasise the importance of a physical staff presence and the concern when that presence is not there. And a lot of concern about all passenger behaviours around the low levels of antisocial behaviour. So rides behaviour, music being played loudly, feet on seats and the influence of alcohol. So when they've got their concerns, the low level of issues structures and how they also done an annual action plan, which I'm going to look at what he said in a minute, and that's just set out how we're going to achieve those aims and objectives we set out in the strategy. And we've also developed a new travel safe partnership grant guidelines. We have a new logo to show the partnership, and pleased to say that's now been adopted by one of our partners not there as well. They have their own travel safe word, but they're now starting to use the partnership logo more and more. So again, people on the network will start to look at how to try to safe and understand what it's about. Okay, so our strategy objectives is, as I said, our vision is to maintain a safe and secure transport environment for customers and staff whilst also improving the customer experience. So our key objectives, which we've slightly adjusted from the previous strategy. So again, we've got in there improving perceptions of safety and security, helping customers and staff feel safer. The next one is preventing and tackling crime and such behaviour on the transport network while travelling. And what we've done there is we've set out a certain key crime types like such behaviour that we'll be looking at. So again, look at the low level ASD, what we can do around that. File crimes both on passengers and also staff. Criminal damage, although significantly reduced, we still do have incidents that occur, and also trespass on the network as well. The new one that we've introduced, again, this way we're sort of adapting to that change in environment, is protecting vulnerable people, so those at greatest risk on the network, or those that won't tend to use the network because of that fear. So that could be around young people, old people, and those with mental health issues. And also we put a commitment in there to look at what we can do to tackle hate crime as well. So just quickly, I'll just show you this, but I won't go into too much detail. So the Travel Safe Action Plan, so again, how we're going to achieve our objectives. We've got a certain activities there that the partnership has agreed to in the next 12 months. Again, this is fluid, so again, we can add to this and adapt as we move along as a board. So we've certainly looked at, we need to develop a marketing communications plan and development. Again, all parts are doing lots of good work out there, but I don't think we shout as a partnership together about what we're doing. So again, there's a commitment there to look at what we're doing marketing communications wise and what we need to do in the next 12 months. Another one there is a commitment around safeguard principles. And as travel has their own safeguard policy, but what we're trying to do now is with the rest of the partners is to have them to develop partnerships about their own principles around safeguard and what their commitments are, so that we have partnership principles on that. We also look at the education strategy again. Lots of partners do lots of work about education, but just need to bring that together here, so we've got a better multimodal approach to that. Another thing we're looking at as well, which is a bus accreditation for schools as well, so support with schools and an accreditation scheme, so that they work close with us as a partnership to keep those incidents down. We're also looking at safe bus stations schemes, while similar to the rail network, so this will be accredited on all bus stations and safe bus stations. And another one is to try and increase our resources. Merseyside Police are trying to get transport operators to sign up to their employee support scheme for the special constabulary relief. Now, Stagecoach have agreed to that, and they said they will allow up to 10 of their bus drivers, if they want to choose to be, to become a special constable and Merseyside Police, and for that they will then release them one day a week to work on the Travel Safe Network once they're trained. So it's quite good news, that one. Okay. So one thing that is on the action plan at the moment, but certainly something we've been talking about is hate crime. We talked about this on our last board, you know, turning back and what we can do. So for those, I'm sure a lot of you do know what hate crime is, but the definition in England and Wales is hate crime any incident which constitutes a criminal offence perceived by the victim or any other person to be motivated by hostility or prejudice. Across the UK, police forces monitor five different strands, these being disability, race, ethnicity or nationality, religion, faith or belief, sexual orientation and gender identity. And those type of crimes can include name calling, verbal abuse, graffiti writing, damage to property, physical attacks or violence, threats, intimidation, bullying and harassment, and more serious things, unfortunately, like murder as well. Hate crime one of those ones that is very important. There's lots of research out there about hate crime and how people do not report this. It's an area I'm quite passionate about, a couple years ago I did a dissertation on hate crime, so I do understand that there is a lot of this, and you do understand that people don't do this. That's for a lot of different reasons. Sometimes people don't recognise that it is hate crime. It's a series of incidents that occur, so that their cars are being targeted and damaged, but they don't actually recognise it that they're being targeted because of a particular protected characteristic. And again, some people, again, the majority of victims are not aware of difficult accessing legal services as well. So again, we understand that it is a real issue across things. To put into context of hate crime on the transport network, the things up there, the top line is Merseyside Police. So last year, in the last 3 years, that's the number of incidents in total that have been reported to Merseyside Police and recorded as hate crime. We've gone through those, and Merseyside Police have for us, and looked into that. And of that, said from last year, of those just under 3,000 incidents reported to Merseyside Police, we've attributed to 57 occurring on the bus network, whether that be at bus stops, on the bus, or at one of our pubs as well. So that's probably around about 2% of hate crime reported to Merseyside Police. Last year, there was just over 1,000 crimes that occurred on the bus network. So again, when we just look at the bus network in its entirety, 5% of hate crimes were hate crime. And British Transport Police as well, that's obviously just the only issues they have is on the rail network. As you can see there, they've had a significant reduction last year from 48 previous year to 10 last year. I have asked for an explanation, which I'm still waiting for, but we're not sure whether that's due to under-reporting or whether it's due to their proactive work that they've done over the last 12 months. Certainly, British Transport Police have done an awful lot of work nationally, so whether that's discouraging people as well. As you can see there, the main strands reported across just Merseyside Police in general and the rail and bus network, the main strands that are reported are racial, sexual orientation and disability crimes. Okay, so as I say, the partnership have done an awful lot of work around this. I think, say, going back to 2011, so for the last 7 years we've done an awful lot of work. And we were recognised again, and people were coming to us to see what we would do. So I think it came about as a sort of probably informing the Equality Act and looking at what we could do to improve reporting and understanding about hate crime. And also, Merseyside Police approached us to say they've met with some groups who were experiencing hate crime on the transport network. So as a result of that, we looked at the different ways that we could encourage reporting, and at the time we decided that Stop Hate UK, which is an independent charity, provides a third-party reporting service for us. So basically, we commissioned them to take calls for us and take details of those things and make them on to us. That's since now been funded across the globe. National and local campaigns, so again there's lots of different hate crime processing, we had a discussion about what we could do as a partnership to re-energise our efforts to tackle this issue. And what we did is we discussed some things there about whether we wanted to develop a plan to focus, coordinate and rationalise our resources to prevent hate crime taking place on transport network. And we talked about reporting, education, how we could maybe travel the network if individuals committed an offence, look to reduce any victimisation, identifying that, look at reporting centres as well, and then also we could look at identifying what works and best practice across other agencies. So again, what we've done there is partners have now gone away, and what we would do is bring the paper back to our transit board in July with some recommendations about what we want to do there. We know as a partnership, or certainly just as nurse travel ourselves, we can't do this alone, and we need to consult with those protected characteristic groups there, because we don't really know what the threats are there, so we need to consult with them and develop that. And we've also had offer as well, there was a hate crime conference a couple of years ago, which some information came there about public transport, and the one of the people that were involved in that is offered assistance when we want to do our own hate crime conference to look specifically at transport and the networks as well. And then I think from that we formulate our responses. I also mentioned before again about the hate crime strategy that was on Merseyside. That was reviewed by the university last year and a number of recommendations. So that hate crime subgroup is part of the Merseyside Just Report. We'll look to refresh that year this year. And certainly ourselves will be signing up to that again. And to look at what particular things we can do to help tackle the issue, not just on public transport, but across Merseyside, so using our efforts together really. It's likely that that will be relaunched in October to coincide with the Hate Crime Awareness Week. So as a partnership, that provides us with a great opportunity to maybe launch what we are going to do to focus our efforts and what we can do with the transport network. Interestingly, as part of my research looking into this, in Edinburgh last year, they introduced a transport charter, which sets out good practice for transport providers and agreed to a number of areas such as hate crime reporting as well as preventing that. So I'm going to do a little bit more research around that and see how they've done that. We've also looked at prohibiting travel as well, so we need to look a bit more into that with our NPC partners as well, what can be done there as well. Also looked to other transport authorities, Transport West Midlands, that has powers to apply for injunctions under the ASB Crime and Policing Act, which allows them to apply for court for civil injunctions against those involved in nuisance in ASB and Manchester. Transport Manchester just about to get those powers. So again, that's something we need to look at as a partnership really, so what we need to help for. So that really concludes just the overview of travel safety. So happy to take any questions.
Thank you so much for that. Okay, I've got Steve first, and then Ken.
Great presentation, and great to see so much where going on. Just a couple of issues. I've looked at the strategy, it doesn't seem to be the use of technology, which is a real sort of area that gives both greater detection of crime when it's taking place, but also reassures passengers and people on the network that they are safe and a deterrent to others who may commit something if they're never going to be caught or be on film or whatever other technology. So that's maybe a section in the strategy around investigating new technologies or technologies around that. And just to relay, we just recently underwent an assessment from an organisation called Navajo, which we went through, and that was a big issue for them, was safety of people they represent, transgender, etc. and stuff like that. So, and I was gonna say, well, are we going out and reaching these groups? Are we talking to them directly? You finished off on your last slide that we're actually going out to those organisations, getting their comments. There's no one, you know, they see it through their eyes and will give good advice and good tips. So, from what I can see, what we're doing as much as we can do. But with those comments, I'd like to congratulate you. So.
Thanks, Steve. I've got Ken, then Ron, then Gordon, then Sammy, then Jerry.
Thanks, Jerome. Excellent presentation, Nick. Thanks very much. Just going back to Steve's technology, we did discuss it on the last Travel Safe Board. We had the Crime Commissioner here, and we discussed linking up and having an system of the body cam, which would link up to everything, so I get the best of both worlds. But what isn't shown here is the people who meet on the Travel Safe Board. And as you're saying, Steve, we do meet virtually with all the organisations. We meet downstairs, we have them all the different organisations, we share ideas, we do all the rest of what we do. Hopefully what, you know, what you want to do, we do. And all this we do to protect our travelling public, which is what we're here for. You know, Nick and her team do a wonderful job, first of all, gathering all these people here together, chief execs, managing directors of various train, bus companies, they're all here to do that. You know, I don't know, Mary in her past as chairman, I'm the only constant, I've been vice chairman, there was a lot of them, but the thing is, we've been doing this over many, many years, and you know, we have developed a wonderful team, and this is just to protect our people and the traveling, traveling public. So, thanks, Nick. Wonderful.
Yeah,
yeah,
I might
you
microphone on account.
Sorry. I'm not aware that we haven't certainly banned anyone from the network from a travel perspective. Whether the South Police or British Transport Police have done that through when they take through to the courts, I'm not too sure. So I don't think it has happened.
Because I think that's something we should be aware of if it has happened.
Yeah.
Frankly, that's the prime piece of meat on the table. Sorry, any vegetarians.
It's a main cause of what
should be an activity. I myself want to wear the football. I remind myself of where football was up to at one particular stage. And then it changed and it skipped racism the red card. I want to see from this transport committee cross-party support that we can work with you and we can take the lead as a transport on this particular issue and we'll work to bring a motion at future meeting that we can do something in regards to that, because it's about time we kicked it out.
As I say, last week we've got to really work with our partners as well about what we can do about banning, whether it's the police one or whether we can do it through the command authority through measures that way.
Thank you, Chair. I'm very happy to have that discussion with yourself and the job of the Chair.
Tony?
Thanks, Nicky. Nicky, the right hand alarm in this report is staff assault, both physical and verbal. Staff assault on the bus network. 79 people, 2016, so 79 people have gone out to do a day's work have been physically assaulted when they've gone to work. Now, there's not many people in here that go into work thinking, I might get physically assaulted today. But the frontline staff, that's what happens. And I'd like to know, did these then become victims? So all those people got to work, and they have to go to work the following day, because they still have to go in front of them through another tape. So the following day, after they've been assaulted, they're going back into work with a bigger fear, because it's already happened to them. Are they getting victim support? And do they get the full support that they need from the operators that they work under with regards to conflict resolution, self-defence, and things like that? Because people really should be moments away worrying about whether they get beat up.
I'd like to certainly think they get support from their employers as well. Again, when someone just reports a crime, again, it's up to whether that driver wants to report that crime to their family. Some drivers do have verbal abuse and decide not to report that. We can't force people to report those crimes. But certainly, I would assume that if they report it to Merseyside Police or British Transport Police, they will be then offered to victim support as well. What we do is our police community support officers go into regular bus depots, and certainly if a bus driver has got an issue or is experiencing, they do pick that up with the police community support officers, and they can advise and help as well. And again, what we do as well is we're just about to do another round, going round certainly the Arriva depots. They've introduced a new function, talk about technology, again, and trying to understand and report it. They've introduced on their ticket machine now a travel safe port for reported incidents. It is on the ticket machines, but we're just waiting for the results and stuff. So basically, rather than a driver filling out a two-page report form, they just press the ticket machine now and they'll come up with a little ticket. So very brief details, but it gives us a little bit more information as well. So we get to make sure that if there are victims there, then maybe it's a partnership. Again, we've got very limited resources to do this as well. Again, it's that balance. If people can do that to give that feedback from this police support officer or that investigating officer. But again, as we've alluded to, the police resources are stretched to how we can do that. But again, we always put the advice out to the drivers, then we'll point them to the victim care website as well. So we do as much as we can to try and help.
Gary?
Thank you. I'll just cover the points as well tonight. One of the main points I'd like to say is, first of all, to thank you for the depth of the report in 70 areas. One of the problems which we've already been highlighting by many people is against the cost to the outside agencies and issues like abandoned calls, by abandoned calls. reports are happening. And, you know, with I was reading an article in the newspaper yesterday comparing the police in New York with the police in London, and of course, with all the issues that are coming up now, London is becoming, you know, there's more murders taking place in London than there are in New York. And the same reason why New York has improved so tremendously, as the Commission said, without resolving resource issues, you are not going to improve the situation. And that's how they've improved the situation, by they compared the figures that have been put into New York, the financial amounts, compared with London. That's just completely unbelievable. We will know where we are about to deal with. But yeah, it's a hell of a substantial problem with London. Thanks for your input. I thought it was really helpful. So thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Yeah, it's quite obvious that since 2004, Travel Safe and the partnership has worked tremendously well in bringing this out of the shadows and into the public notice. We know now that, you know, a lot of people, even the public, just saying, get your feet off that and see, you know, it's brought it into the public psyche. Also, the work that you've done has brought other sections together to really think about this, because obviously it's all been done separately in the past, but now it's being thought about together and how you can help each other, which I think is fantastic. Have you been approached, you know, we've got new trains coming in, have you been approached by, when we've been formulating these new trains and so forth, on your input into safety within the new train system? I noticed that on your report it says that on the trains, and that would be interesting to find out whether that is just because the reporting had gone right down on the trains, incidents on the trains, or whether it's a genuine figure and it's had an impact. I'd like to know about that, but have you had any input into our new trains, and have you been invited to do that?
I haven't had any direct input whether our part of the partnership have had an impact on that. Certainly, I'm sure the transport police and parts like that have been. As well, I'm trying to say for the October one, we did a visual on the residential new trains as well, just to show that was an effect. So I haven't had any direct input. I've had any conversations in the past with the team, but not any direct input. So they're probably more connected to it.
Just to add to that, the British Transport Police is the statutory police force for the railway, how they call it, being involved in the Robinson project.
Yeah, that's great.
Okay. If there's no further questions, I'm not time. I'm doing a lot of echoing today. But no, seriously, Nick, you and your sort of team have done an exceptional job. Travel Safe has really been a success story, and we shouldn't sort of lose sight of the fact that got one of the safest, if not the safest, transport networks anywhere in the country. And we know how important that is because of the people's sort of perception of fear of crime on social media and instances happening. There's a real disincentive to travel. People don't feel safe, they won't travel. So the fact that we've done the work we already have has benefited that. But obviously, we always need to be kind of focusing on emerging issues and further issues. We can't just rest on our laurels, and particularly the kind of points that the Gordon's been making about hate crime and those wider issues. We know that that's a new emerging problem we've got to kind of come down very, very strongly and continue to keep on raising our game on that. We obviously look forward to how we work together on that to develop that kind of approach even further. So really well done on what you did. We look forward to that continuing to. Okay, in fact, if we can note presentation, Gordon, really thank Nick for that. Obviously, if you have to come back at a future juncture, that would be fantastic. Moving on to item 8, we've got proposal for distributing additional pothole action fund allocation 2017-18, and Devon's going to review this for us.
Thanks,
Chair.
Basically, at the budget meeting on the 3rd of February last year, the CA approved that the region's allocation of pothole action funding for 17-18 of 1.34 formula be allocated to districts via the normal DfT formula. In February this year, which is the basis of this report, the DfT awarded additional funding of almost £1 million to the region. So as detailed in Table 2 of the report you've got in front of you, we're recommending that this is also distributed via the DfT formula. Then we had a further announcement on the 26th of March to say that further pothole and flood resistance funding of £1.86 million for the region was going to come to us. £1.38 million was received on the 29th of March last Thursday, and the remainder is coming in April. The accompanying letter states that this represents all of the funds that the DfT is expected to give to us this year from the Pothole Action Fund and for flood resistance. So again, the recommendation for both additional allocations is that funding is distributed by the DfT formula, and the report will be amended accordingly to go to the CEO. It's worth noting that in the press release for both allocations, that they detail the breakdown for each district. But the DfT has since confirmed that in the future, any such funding will be just one allocation for the LCR, and that will be up to the CA to distribute to that as they see fit.
Is there any questions or comments, Steve?
Yeah, I did inquire before the meeting how the national formula was calculated, and I think it's basically done on the length of roads in each region. Because the reason I asked that question, because historically this government has not favoured the north, and particularly northern metropolitan authorities, in funding of all kinds. So this seems to be fair in terms of the methodology used. What I would say though is all those other unfair funding allocations that we've had in the past has put adverse and a lot more pressure on our highways departments in each of the local authorities. Because most of it, as you know, we're all approaching the sort of graph of doom scenario where the only funding available will go either on adult social care or children's services in the sort of broad terms, and we're all approaching that sort of that position. So all I'm saying is that this is welcome, because any extra money is welcome, but those other pressures put on by central governments have probably meant our roads are in the north are in a slightly worse condition than other areas that have had more fair funding in the past. So I just thought that was a point worth making, reiterating. It won't be enough to cure the potholes. It will go towards helping, and I think every single penny will be spent when it's meant to be spent on potholes and the like. But I just thought that point was worth reiterating. And it is an issue for the public. You know, I think all of us as local councillors get those letters, get those phone calls. I've damaged my car, I've gone through a pothole, X, Y, and Z road is in a terrible state, and it really is a pressure that all authorities need to react to. So the money will be spent where it's allocated for. I wish it could have been more.
Yeah, 100%, because obviously the money will be put to good use, but it says drop in the ocean to pebble in a pothole, and we're talking about sticky plasters with all of this. Frankly, when we look at the way the kind of funding's been cut to local government and the way that it's acted on it, direct impact on our highway networks in this city region beyond, it's not just here, but kind of, we know that sort of, whilst this money will get used well, it's nowhere near the amount that is required. And when we think about the amount that sort of local road users pay to the Treasury, a much better allocation is certainly warranted. Les?
Yes, yeah, well, basically, I don't find myself quite often agreeing with Steve, but I will agree with him and yourself, Chair, on this one. I think in the past that sometimes we've not had a fair allocation, and the work, you know, even baffles me at sometimes how they sort of work this out in government, you know, who gets what. And we always see that the London boroughs and so forth get a hell of a lot more than what we do. But having said that, you know, I do welcome, you know, the extra funding. It is, you're quite right, it is a drop in the bucket, considering, you know, what we've had to go through over the last 10 years or so. The roads are in a terrible state. So I'm welcoming of the funding that's coming to Wirral here, and especially the updated one you've had. actually what I will certainly agree with that.
Gordon Lenrock.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, I think this place is right to agree with one on this occasion.
I was just thinking I've got that pleasure to buy me. That's what it is. But when I got the figures too, and I looked at them, this is just over 1% of what's needed. The total bill so far, there's no, is £9.3 million, and so it's an if anyone's going to dance up in excitement on this announcement, then they're going to be a little bit disappointed. It wasn't particularly noticeable here.
Absolutely. What we've got around is that our road network is a key part of our infrastructure.